This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today I have another exciting episode for you today, and today's topic is a subject that's very near and dear to my heart. Actually, it's one of the main reasons why I got into, you know, being crazy and convert my whole front yard to a raised bed edible garden. I'm converting the backyard to grow all raised bed edible vegetable garden, and why I'm growing my own food. And this video will sum it up and let you guys know the two best ways you can grow more nutritious crops, higher nutrients in your crops, because let me tell you, big agribusiness and most conventional and even organic farmers are not doing some of these things that I'm going to share with you guys today. So first I want to talk about why we need to do this. John, I could buy apples and oranges, pears, bananas, and celery and lettuce at the store. I mean, they're good, right? Well, yeah, I mean, I advocate eating as much fresh fruits and vegetables as possible because most people just don't eat enough fresh fruits and vegetables, you know, number one. Number two, the reason why there's fruits and vegetables in the store is not because they're trying to make the world a healthier place. It's because of the almighty dollar. The farmers are in it, and the big agribusinesses that own most of the farms these days, the commercial farms, are in it just to make a profit, to make money. I mean, that's what makes the world go around, right? Well, I hope not, you know, but anyways, you know, so they're doing it and they're cutting corners. They may be spraying pesticides on conventional products, and they might be doing things even in organic agriculture that I wouldn't necessarily agree with or wouldn't want to do myself. So I learned that I had to do it myself. Why? Because, you know, it's proven that since the 1950s, nutrition in the same standard cabbage, cauliflower, celery, turnips overall has gone down. Actually, here's a printout here of cauliflower nutrient change 1950 to 1999. So on here it shows that there's 2.6 more calcium. So wow, that's gone up, man. There's more calcium in the cauliflower today than yesteryear. But there's 31% less vitamin C. There's 37% less riboflavin. There's 37.3% less phosphorus, and there's 58.9% less iron. Man, maybe you could become iron deficient by eating vegetables that are conventionally grown, because in the 1950s, they had more nutrition in there. That's totally crazy. So why is this nutrient deficient food being sold to us? Well, you know, one of the main reasons, in my opinion, is the farmers are putting NPK back in the soil. That makes it grow stuff, but is it giving it all the nutrients? Is it replacing the iron that was previously pulled out on former crops? Is vitamin C content going to be high when the plants is not getting everything it needs, you know? Maybe not. So one of the reasons for the change, in my opinion, is the soil is not being managed properly. We're not giving back and putting back into the soil what we've taken out over, you know, years and years and years of conventional, even organic farming, number one. Second reason why it may be lower is because the way they've calculated these variables, so that may play you know, a factor in why it's a little bit lower, but I don't know about 58%, 37%. That seems like quite a bit. Another reason why it may be lower is because of the seed stock they're using. Back in the 1950s, they probably had more heirloom type, you know, seeds that weren't crossbred for certain traits, like being shipped far, like dropping, and a tomato not breaking. You know, they were not selected necessarily for, you know, more profit and more profitability. They were selected for because they tasted good, because they looked red, because, you know, whatever else characteristics. So, you know, to go on further about this stuff, let's take a look at the nutritional analysis of cornmeal. And all this is simply comparing is Heirloom Floriani Red Flint cornmeal to conventional cornmeal from USDA values for de-germ cornmeal. And as you guys can see in this chart, like on most of the things on heirloom crops, or on this particular heirloom red cornmeal, some of the nutrition, you know, is double. Fiber is 4 grams. On the heirloom one, it's 11 grams. Niacin's 2.2. On the conventional, it's 1.0. You know, on the riboflavin, it's 0.5. On the heirloom, it's 0.17. I mean, everything's like that. So, you know, what's really important to me are two things. Number one, we want to grow the most nutrient-dense crops we can by adding things in the soil that conventional farmers are not putting in. So some of those things, in my opinion, probably the most important thing is the compost. You guys know that I religiously talk about adding compost to your garden, whether you're adding the bacterial compost and the thermal compost that you make in your own composter, and hopefully it's getting a high temperature so it's cooking down pretty good. or you're adding the fungal dominated compost or the low or no heat compost that's basically made by composting wood chips or the carbon with the fungus and the mushrooms and whatnot into a nice fungal dominated compost. So those composts are also very important. In addition, the worm castings are critically important in my opinion. Worm castings are very important to produce healthy crops in my opinion. But even more so than just the composts is something else that can be more challenging to add, because think about it. In the compost you're adding in, it's from the food scraps or from the things you're putting into it. And if those food scraps you're putting in are based on organic or even conventional crops, they may not have the nutrition in there in the first place. So then how are they gonna all of a sudden magically appear from your compost if they weren't in the starting base material in the beginning? So that's why, you know, next to the compost, you gotta add these guys. These are called rock dust, granulated rock dust. Actually, this is a granulated natural rock dust. I prefer the micronized version. The finer the particle size, the more available it is for the plants and the microbes in the soil. And you know, the rock dust you see here add like 70 plus trace minerals into the soil to give the plant what it needs, because as you saw what the farmers are currently doing, adding NPK, and that's, you could be doing the same thing by adding, you know, many of the different bright orange colored, you know, conventional fertilizers out of the box, or, you know, other standard fertilizers you buy at a fertilizer shop. You know, you're just adding NPK, and that's not going to get you the highest quality foods. You got to add the compost, the rock dust, you got to add, you know, the soil microorganisms, the beneficial fungi, the beneficial, you know, bacteria, you know, the beneficial nematodes, the earthworms. We want a living soil. We want to duplicate what's found in nature. Be sure to check some of my other videos for that. But yeah, rock dust, super important. Stay tuned for an upcoming episode where I specifically talk about more details on the rock dust. We'll just leave it at that. So that's the first way. You want to definitely include the rock dust. What you're going to find after including the rock dust is, number one, your food's going to taste better. When it tastes better, that's because it has more flavonoids in it. And guess what? Flavonoids, a base of flavonoids is flavor. So it's going to have more flavor in it. That means it's going to be more nutritious. Things that generally taste better are more nutritious. Number one, more flavonoids, going to taste better, more nutritious. Number two, you're going to have higher yields. The crops you grow, you're going to grow larger. They're going to grow bigger. You're going to get more yield for the same amount of plants you're growing. Definitely a good thing. Number three, the plants are going to be healthier. So when plants are healthier, they're going to be more bug and disease resistant. So that's definitely also really important. Plus, you're going to be putting back into the soil, into the ground, what we've been taking out and what, you know, erosion has been taken away over all these years. We're going to give back to the earth instead of just being greedy and keep taking from it. So I always encourage you guys to, you know, if you stay at a friend's house, leave it a little bit nicer than you left it, and leave your land a little bit nicer, a little bit better condition than when you started farming it. Because most farming practices, unfortunately, in my opinion, leave the land worse. So that's number one. You definitely want to do that. Number two, this way is even easier than trying to find some rock dust, because it can be hard to find. Be sure to check my other videos on my sources for rock dust and where you could actually order it online for fairly inexpensive. The number two way is super simple. It's actually by just getting different seeds. So instead of getting hybridized seeds, which I also grow hybridized seeds and modern seeds of today are maybe bred for certain characteristics, whether it's disease resistance, whether it's, you know, for, you know, better shipability, and it travels better, long lasting, you know, doesn't go bad, whether it's for, you know, the texture, you know, some of these things that are being bred out of it are things like the nutrition aspects of the food. And those are some of the things that are most important to me. So you want to get heirloom seeds. I have some examples of heirloom seeds right here. We got some melon Calavon Espanol. We got some okra Perkins long pod. We got some squash Pomme d'Or. I mean, a place like Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds, I mean, it's called Baker Creek Heirloom Seed Company. And it's rareseeds.com is their website. So you want to always try to get heirloom seeds whenever possible. Plus, the heirloom seeds are open pollinated, which means you can't save your seeds and replant them the following year. You'll get the exact same thing. And guess what? If you're growing heirloom seeds in the rock dust, your starting seed stock for next year will be even stronger and healthier than the year before. And keep saving your multiple generations of seed stock that's grown in rich, nutritious soil, you're going to have better seed stock than anybody. And we all know that the seed stock that you start with, you know, has to do partly with how your plants turn out. You know, it's the genetics of the plant plus the nutrition in the soil. So by combining both genetics with the heirloom seeds and the soil and getting the rock dust, the compost in there, you're definitely going to be firing on all eight cylinders. Now, the last thing I want to tell you guys is actually kind of sad, but, you know, I just want to let you guys know anyways. Here's the nutritional analysis between GMO corn versus non-GMO corn, right? So check it out. Non-GMO corn, and this is just conventional corn, not even organic corn, is much higher in nutrition than the GMO corn. So it's like, you know, GMO corn's like the worst, then like, you know, conventional crops and non-heirloom seeds, some hybrids, certain varieties, of course. There are certain varieties of hybrids that are grown for specific nutrients nowadays. And then we got the heirloom seeds. So think good, better, best, right? I don't want you guys growing the GMO corn because the nutrition is much less than just non-GMO corn. But you could get better by doing heirloom seeds. And the reason why I bring this up is because GMO corn and other crops are a big threat to standard heirloom crops. For those of you guys that don't know, you know, I almost lost my life when I was younger, and this basically made me start thinking a little bit differently and made me start really realizing and valuing my health and me wanting to do whatever I could do to increase my health instead of decrease it. I mean, we all know that cigarettes have a warning thing on it, says, you know, may cause cancer. When you smoke, you're probably decreasing your health. When you're eating foods out of your garden grown in rock dust and heirloom, you're increasing your health, in my opinion, and that's what I want each and every one of you guys to do. So by all means, stop buying GMO foods, because besides just the growing GMO that I don't want you guys to do, GMO foods are appearing in grocery stores with, you know, anything that has corn syrup, corn flour, corn meal, corn oil, you know, soybeans and, you know, soy oil, cottonseed oil. So many different processed foods products have these GMO, organisms in it. And if you don't support them, the companies will no longer grow them. So I want you guys to minimize the consumption of processed foods and eat more heirloom, open pollinated, rock dust mineralized, composted plants out of your garden. So hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode. Once again, grow mineral-rich foods, add the rock dust, compost back into your garden to bring fertility back in the soil, leave it better than you found it, and then grow the heirloom crops and eat mostly out of your garden instead of the grocery store. I just wanted to end this video with the fact that actually I'm currently at the airport on my way to the third annual National Heirloom Expo taking place in Santa Rosa, California. It's September 10th, 11th, and 12th, and yes, it is during the week, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. If you do live in the Bay Area anywhere, I definitely encourage you highly to take a day off work. I mean, I said this last year, and there's people that actually took a day off work, and they thanked me for it afterwards. They're like, John, this is one of the best days I ever took off work, you know, to be at the Heirloom Expo. You definitely want to be out. If you still can make it out to the third annual Heirloom Expo, I definitely would strongly encourage you to do it. It's definitely one of the best gardening events that I attend all year. There's going to be information about heirlooms and growing plants with fertile soil. You'll be able to meet actually some of the very people I interview on my show, like Ian from Biologic Systems, Josh from Boogie Brew, and a whole bunch of other people. Also, there'll be a good source of rock dust in Santa Rosa, California. If you haven't already picked some up, that's actually really cheap, cheapest place I've seen to get it. All in all, it's gonna be a great time, and be sure to stop by and say hi to me. I'll be giving a lecture there and also have a booth there probably. So you can learn more at theheirloomexpo.com. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode. Once again, two things: build your soil to build better plants, the rock dust, the compost, worm castings, definitely top my list. And finally, grow heirlooms, and hope to see you at the third annual National Heirloom Expo. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And remember, keep on growing.